Hello everyone and welcome to our CENTO webinar, Niemann Pick Type C Disease, often overlooked, CentoGene's fast and efficient screening programs. In today's webinar, we have with us Professor Peter Bauer, Chief Scientific Officer of CentoGene. He will discuss the challenge with rare variant classification medical interpretation, CentoGene's integrated diagnostic concept for rare diseases, and lastly, the value of biomarkers in rare diseases, biomarkers in Niemann-Pick type C disease. If you have any questions, please enter them into the Q&A chat, and we will refer back to them at the end of the presentation. It promises to be a very interesting webinar, so let us begin.
Yeah, a warm welcome from my side as well. I'm Peter Bauer, Chief Scientific Officer at CentoGene, a human geneticist, and evidently since almost 20 years engaged in Niemann-Pick type C, a disease that was molecularly characterized in 1997. Back then, we have learned a lot on that disease, but even learned a lot more about many other diseases because the rare diseases have gained much attention with next generation sequencing. And so we are now in an environment where CentoGene can offer very precise, sometimes as well very broad diagnostic tools. And I want to guide you through this journey where we have a look at the challenge we face in variant classification and medical interpretation, which leads us to a concept where we integrate not only DNA analysis, but also biomarker analysis to come to more accurate conclusions in rare diseases. And I will exemplify that with Niemann-Pick type C disease in the third part of the talk, where you can see how the biomarker we have developed really brings value to the patients and to the understanding of this often overlooked disease. So when we analyze the challenge we have right now in genetic diagnostics, but as well just genomic medicine, we basically go back to the huge target region of a human genome with many, many bases, more than 3 billion available on two chromosome sets. So we have many of those responsible for gene function, which we call coding exons. Within those exons, but as well the non-coding part of the genome, every individual, every healthy person has more than 4 million, mostly benign variants, which just reflect the variability in the human population. But when a patient, for example, a Niemann-Pick type C patient needs diagnostic attention, we have to find the one and decisive variant that is causing the disease. And so we have a huge problem, or at least a huge challenge in identifying that one. We will come to that more in detail, but just to give you a very short one-pager on the technology gains we had from next-generation sequencing. We have derived an accredited, validated diagnostic workflow where we put sample prep and DNA prep when receiving the sample into a workflow where we then do the DNA enrichment and the sequencing on Illumina machines, which is basically a two-step approach where we have an amplification step and in the part three of the illustration, the sequencing part with imaging of fluorescent dyes parallel for millions of individual sequence reads. Those are then taken through a bioinformatic pipeline. Variants are identified, annotated, and then interpreted by experts and reported back in the context of the clinical question. You can now imagine that these many variants we see, most of them being benign, needs a very tight and standardized classification. And we are happy to have guidance through the American College of Medical Genetics guidelines for variant classification and strictly stick to that. So we decide on the identification of a variant, whether this one is pathogenic or likely pathogenic, or benign or likely benign, or as a VOS, a variant of uncertain significance, whether we can't decide on the effect of that variant. The clinical message there is that we deliver a probability of error in this classification, which means when we decide it to be pathogenic, the chance that we have to reclassify that variant in the future will be less than 1%, and you can really rely a diagnostic conclusion and a therapeutic action on such reports. The same is true for variants that are likely pathogenic, while variants of uncertain significance, and for sure the benign or likely benign, will not be linked to any therapeutic action. Now, on the gene level, next generation sequencing was as well a challenge because we had to identify very definitive genes with high evidence, and Niemann-Pick type C disease genes, NPC1 and NPC2, both have those definitive strong evidence. From those that are not yet established, that might be look like a Niemann-Pick type C-like family without mutations or variants in those genes, and genes that are disputed or even have evidence against. I will go in more detail for this in the breakdown for Niemann-Pick type C, but I want to share with you at least the concept that we need a diagnostic gene with definitive or strong evidence to offer predictive testing. And this is, of course, relevant for patients and families with Niemann-Pick type C disease, because only then a prenatal diagnostic, for example, is possible and to be offered. Since we have so much evidence for the disease genes, all the genes fall into that category. But when you run exome sequencing or genome sequencing, you can imagine that there is room for discovery and sometimes room for debate, where we have many more genes that are to be discussed. Now, it's not only that we have the genes and the variants, we also need tight workflows for variant reclassification, because the evidence in medicines is never something that cannot change over time. So when we start to see a variant the first time, usually we have problems to assign a pathogenicity or likely benign attribution to it. We need repeated observations, or we need evidence from biochemistry or biomarkers to decide on these variants. And you must know that rare disease variants usually are private, so we see them within one family, but then it takes a long time or many, many cases to observe the very same variant again in another patient with the same disease. So it's hard to collect this evidence, and therefore it's even more important to database all evidence you have with the classification, with the evidences, to make the future diagnostics better and better. To enhance that, we have built up our mutation database, which bridges between the genotypes we have seen in the lab, so from sequencing, and the related clinical symptoms in the patient. And for an NPC patient, for example, we would usually see a variant in NPC1, and we would see phenotypes like ataxia, cognitive decline, hepatosplenomegaly, and symptoms that are typical for NPC, maybe even the archetypal symptom of vertical nuclear gaze palsy. So the combination of both observations and the repeated observations in independent families gives us a high evidence to directly classify variants as being pathogenic, and then provide, of course, a very accurate diagnosis. This can even be enhanced by biochemical or biomarker evidence, because these are quantitative measures of disease. And when validated, of course, tell us something about the extent of the effect of a variant on the pathway that is hampered, for example, in NPC. We will look into that in the third part. CentMD has a huge variety of information for metabolic and non-metabolic diseases, and for NPC 1-2, it's the same picture. We have roughly more than 50% of the variants classified within the database that have not been seen by any other source, and so you can really access very valuable information there. Meanwhile, this database reflects close to 200,000 analyzed individuals. The origin of information is worldwide, and so it also helps, of course, to discuss and decide on variants you've seen in populations that are rarely studied in the large genome project. Now, this is the introduction and tells you something about the challenges and the scope of genetic testing. When we look into Niemann Pick type C more specifically, we have a disease with a metabolic component, which already led to some preliminary biomarkers or markers in the past. And why not combining evidence from DNA and proteins for comprehensive diagnostics? So when we recapitulate what James Watson already claimed, which is the central dogma of molecular biology, that DNA is translated into RNA and then into protein, of course we have a problem that the DNA change leads through this cascade into a cellular phenotype. The cellular phenotype is then usually an organ dysfunction like the hepatosplenomegaly or the cataplexy in Niemann-Pick type C. And of course, then as a physician, you would describe a young child with ataxia and those symptoms that are typical for a Niemann-Pick type C. So the clinician sees the overall picture. The molecular biologist or the DNA diagnostic lab just sees the DNA, and we have to make a chain out of evidences from DNA through the clinical phenotype to link the evidences. So sometimes it's difficult because we see variants that affect the gene but maybe are not relevant for the clinical phenotype. And in this respect, the molecular phenotype, which is reflected in biochemical markers or broadly spoken in biomarkers, is an ideal stepping stone to jump from DNA with evidence added to the clinical phenotype or the other way around. How is CentroGene making use of integrated diagnostics? We have developed and validated a tool for the logistics, which is the CentroCart. The nice thing about this dried blood spot filter card is that we can derive DNA analysis and biomarker analysis in the same sample. And since these cards are very easy to prepare, easy to ship, easy to store, and very stable, we have a highly accurate diagnostic workflow when you are using these filter cards for the diagnostic tests. On the side of the biochemistry, we have developed biomarker tests by mass spectrometry, which is a complementary method to DNA sequencing. We can go into the plasma metabolites or proteomic components and then identify molecules by their charge and by their weight. I won't go into detail there as well, but in the end, we can really highly sensitively look into the metabolic profile of patients and controls, and by comparison then identify markers that characterize disease. This method is extremely sensitive, while an enzymatic test would, for example, illustrated here, need a truck of sugar being dissolved in the Munich arena filled with water. Our mass spectrometry-based biomarker tests would even identify a piece of sugar being dropped into that large bowl. So you can imagine that this most recent technology allows us to engage in ultra-sensitive diagnostic tests. Now, we have applied that successfully on a huge list of metabolic diseases, but as well more and more non-metabolic diseases. And you can see down in the biomarker field that NPC-509, the biomarker for Niemann-Pick type C disease, is tandem mass spectrometry based and can be measured in dried blood spot and plasma. So it makes it very, very convenient and stable as a diagnostic test. You don't have to centrifuge or cool samples to get the biomarker result from us. Now, let's go to Niemann-Pick type C disease now, because the scene is set to understand what we have implemented there. Looking at the disease, it's known for more than 100 years right now, because Albert Niemann described the first patient in 1914. They discovered that they have cells with some storage inside. This was Ludwig Pick in 1927, and then the combination of these observations then led to the lineage of a syndrome called Niemann-Pick type, Niemann-Pick disease. Back that time, of course, the physicians couldn't dissect between different subtypes, and they had a classification based on the clinic into four types, which is the severity of the liver involvement in type A and B, and rather the neurodegenerative cause in C and D. Later, we Kanfer and Penchev worked on the molecular causes and could show that AB probably is an enzyme deficiency, which was later then defined as sphingomyelinase deficiency, while Peter Penchev at NIH in 1984 delineated that NPC is a separate entity with a defect in cholesterol metabolism. But it took another 13 years to clone the more prevalent NPC1 gene and another 10 years to come up with a first approved therapy for NPC patients, which was one of the early orphan drug treatments available in the field. Now, Niemann-Pick type C is rare, so it's a rare disease with an incidence of 1 in 100,000, but maybe incidence is higher if we would extend our diagnostic abilities into niches where patients have not been looked at yet. I already mentioned that there are two genes, NPC1 and NPC2. I will show you in a cartoon on the next slide what their cellular function is, but we have identified patients all over the world, and the biochemical alteration is mainly an impaired trafficking of lipids in the cell. This mainly affects, of course, cholesterols and helps us to explain why many patients have a neural phenotype, because cholesterol is so detrimental for the brain. But as well, it alters pathways and metabolism, so we have an accumulation of glycosphingolipids, which can be measured in the tissue. This leads to neurodegeneration, a tau-like pathology with dementia as well, but not only the brain, many other organs are affected, especially liver and spleen in the visceral phenotype. Now on the cellular level, NPC1 protein is localized in the late endosome and helps to cycle those lipid droplets in the cell from the endoplasmatic reticulum to the cell surface and back. So it's kind of a shuttle for complex lipids and helps to reestablish or maintain membrane, cell membrane integrity, and other membrane dependent intracellular processes. So patients have a missorting of cholesterol and glycosphingolipids, which leads to cellular stress, but also helped to develop the first diagnostic test, which was the Philippine staining. You can see in the fibroblast of NPC mutant cells that all the cholesterol as imaged by Philippine stays around the nucleus, which is the Golgi, and cannot escape from there, while in wild type cells, the NPC protein helps to transport the fatty moieties throughout the cell. So the transport is disturbed, which leads to a disturbed metabolism of glycosylceramides, and in the long run, a neurodegeneration. When we look at the neuropathology, which is, of course, the life or often the life limiting complication or progression of the disease, all types of neurons and the whole brain is affected. But we have first manifestations, especially in the cerebellum, leading to early onset ataxia in the brainstem, which triggers the eye movement phenotype, and later and we have a dysfunction of the ion channels as well, so leading to cataplexy. While in the later stages of disease, we have brain atrophy and dementia in the patients. The non-brain symptoms are characterized by organ damage through storage of these complex lipids. The so-called foam cells are packed into visceral organs. They get enlarged, hepatomegaly, splenomegaly. And of course, this is a symptom that the newborn has to cope with. So we have prominent symptomatology in childhood. The older the patients get, the less these visceral symptoms really define the phenotype. There is agreed recommendations for the detection diagnosis of Niemann-Pick type C disease, published in December last year. And we have discussed and agreed on a diagnostic algorithm that starts with the clinical suspicion, which can be measured by specific suspicion indexes. But then in the initial screening, depending on the availability of resources, you can either go for a biomarker or for a genetic panel to diagnose NPC. Genetic confirmation is then the rule if the initial suspicion is substantiated through the initial screening. And then, of course, if special cases are seen, you can go for confirmatory tests. Still, Philippine staining is available in a couple of special laboratories. And then you establish the diagnosis being NPC or not Niemann-Pick type C. What is important to know is that the clinical picture, which I characterize as being visceral and neurodegenerative, is very complex and evolving over time. While, as I already mentioned, the systemic involvement is usually severe in early stage. So if the child is sick at birth, it's usually the very fatal liver disease that can't be compensated. While, as you can see in this wonderful chart of Marie Vanier, the hepatosplenomegaly resolves over the years, while the progressive neurodegeneration from early infantile missing milestones, the cerebellar phenotype with gait problems and clumsiness, and then the juvenile and adult phenotypes with the behavioral problems, the trend to have psychiatric disturbances is very high in the patients, and that is especially seen in adult patients which show dystonia, psychiatric problems, and dementia. It's a very complex composite of these symptoms. Now, we thought at the beginning, 25 years back, that Niemann-Pick type C is a childhood disease, but when going for the late onset phenotypes with ataxia and dementia, we happen to see that there's a substantial part of these patients as well Niemann-Pick type C positive. Substantial means more than 1%. So in the Zoom study published 5 years ago, we could identify three positive patients by a screening test. And I show you the figures here of the publication, because this was the first large prospective clinical study where we combined DNA sequencing and a biomarker, which was that time the triol biomarker developed by then Ori's lab in University of Washington. The positives had positive values. We had a couple of carriers with in-between values, and all those that were tested negative had normal values, except for this one patient that could not be followed up. Meanwhile, 5 years later, we have executed more screening studies and seen that Niemann-Pick type C patients really are hidden in niches that needs to be searched for to offer those patients as well a diagnosis and the option to be treated accordingly. Now, our tool for supporting these patient screenings in niches is the biomarker LISO SM509, which has been characterized and published 3 years ago by our team. And I will show you a little bit the performance of this biomarker. You would expect that a biomarker, of course, identifies NPC patients, and that's shown here in the red bar. All positive genetically proven patients had elevated biomarker levels, except for two that were under treatment and therefore had probably reduced biomarker levels. But the normal controls and the carriers were below the threshold, while the NPC patients were above. You can see another 7 patients with elevated biomarkers, which is interesting, and therefore the specificity is not 100%, but we could follow up these patients and learned that they have Niemann-Pick type AB disease. So the biomarker LISO SM509 is specific for the spectrum of Niemann-Pick diseases, including sphingomyelinase deficiency. When we compare the biomarker with existing biomarkers, I already mentioned the triol marker of then Ori, we see they perform pretty similar. But when you look in detail into the test characteristics, you can see that the LISO 509 especially has a very, very tight distribution of normal control values. This is, of course, an advantage because this offers a very dynamic marker for the NPC patient measured, while in other biomarkers, the healthy controls are closer to the diseased patients and have more noise in their distribution. That's especially true for the LISO tracker shown in panel C, which did not approve as a reliable biomarker. The other thing we've tested with the biomarker is to look how it correlates with the known genotypes, wild type, carrier, or patient, which is green, black, and red, and as well whether it correlates with the other quantitative marker, the triol shown on the y-axis. And what you can derive is that we have quite a good correlation between both biomarkers. We have a dynamic range from 0.05 to 10 in the LISO sphingomyelin 509 and a dynamic range of 10 to 100 in the cholestan triol. So in terms of the separation of signals, the 509 offers more room. Nonetheless, you can see pretty similar results. Now, what is the integrated diagnostic workflow in our laboratory? When we receive a sample, it should be a filter card sample, because then we can easily split into both tracks of analysis. We first of all execute the biomarker. If the biomarker is normal, we are sure that the patient is not suffering from Niemann-Pick disease. If the biomarker is pathogenic, we add another biomarker that is able to dissect the rare sphingomyelinase deficiency. So, and if the second analysis is pathogenic, we know it's Niemann-Pick type AB disease, and we are going for confirmatory sequencing in the SMPD1 gene. If the second biomarker is normal, we conclude that the patient is suffering from Niemann-Pick type C disease and go for confirmation with NPC1-2 sequencing. Very straightforward, can be executed within 1 week, and the accuracy of this combined approach is very, very high. So what have we seen with this approach in in-house doing screening and patient identification programs? Here I have collected from our internal database the numbers available with 240 patients and 146 carriers. Most of the diagnosed patients, so that's the NPC patients. We have another 100 SMPD1 Niemann-Pick RB patients. And for the genotypes leading to the symptoms, we have seen, like published, that most of the patients have NPC1 disease with mutations in that gene, while only 8 had proven mutations in NPC2. So the distribution is almost 95% NPC1 genotypes. The origin of our samples, which you can look up in our mutation database, is mainly from Europe, 50%, but then we have 30% patients from the Middle East, 12% from Latin America, even almost 8% from Africa, and small proportions from Asia and the North Americas. So that's really showing and reflecting the diversity of information we have. Age at onset, you can see, is on average 10 years for NPC1. And 3 years for NPC2, which is usually more severe. But you can see there's a broad range of variants. So we have neonatal onset in NPC1, and the oldest patient was 46 years old when symptoms started. When we look at the clinical information that has been linked to the patients, we see that that many cases mentioned visceral symptoms, because we have, as you've seen, onset of symptoms with 10 years. So that's clearly within the childhood or infantile phase. But as well, we have almost similar frequencies of neurodevelopmental and neurodegenerative symptoms, which is then especially ataxia, and with less frequencies, psychopathology, going into psychiatric symptoms, spasticity, seizures, and so on. So this is a huge variety of symptoms, and you can see that really more than 20 items have been mentioned by our referring physicians. So when we look into the evidence I have now shared with you, I think we can summarize that NPC is really a very exemplary and important rare disease, because it shows us the challenges in the diagnostic process, but as well in the translation of the diagnostic process into actionable clinic. Since NPC is treatable, The early diagnosis is so relevant because we can postpone severe symptoms for patients by putting them on drugs and help them, of course, to cope better with this really devastating neurodegenerative disease. You've seen that the phenotype is very broad and that the clinical differential diagnosis alone is unable to uncover all hidden patients. And so if we don't want to postpone or delay diagnosis, we should be very open to offer screening tools for example, all children with ataxia or with liver disease, just to not overlook those admittedly rare cases where a specific therapy nonetheless can be offered. I think you are with me that the combination of biomarker screening and genetic screening is a very powerful tool to be applied on such hidden cohorts. The last point I would like to raise in the summary is that, of course, the interpretation issue we usually face with sequencing-only approaches can be largely overcome when a biomarker is available, because this biomarker helps us to decide on the dignity of a missense variant and either classify it as likely pathogenic or likely benign based on the combination of the clinical picture and the biomarker value. Having said that, I think I thank you for your attention. Might want to draw your attention to workshops we are organizing right now in the Middle East. So if you are in that region, don't hesitate to register for an update on the early diagnostic program for Niemann-Pick type C disease, either on July 4th in Riyadh or on July 5th in Jeddah. Registration links are given here on the slide or on our homepage, and you can see that there is a distinguished speaker program to give you more background on these really important, interesting, and challenging diagnoses and diseases. Now, I think it's time for questions and answers, but before I ask you for your questions, I would remind you that you will receive an automatic poll after this webinar, and we would be very happy if you would invest another 2 or 5 minutes to give us feedback on the quality of the presentation, the takeouts you had, and what we can do better or what we already did great this time. Thank you at that moment, and now the channel is open for questions.
Thank you, Professor, for sharing your knowledge with us. We have a question here, and it goes like this. Is NPC also diagnosed through whole exome sequencing as compared with a dedicated test?
Yeah, I think that's important, because we always discuss, do we miss patients when we are not the experts and just suspect a genetic disease and ask for whole exome or whole genome sequencing? The answer is usually NPC is also diagnosed there, because the sensitivity of whole exome sequencing is as well more than 95%. So you will rarely miss a scenario where the patient-specific mutation is not in the coding region or is not covered by your test. On the other side, what I should still add is, if you have the suspicion that this is NPC and a whole exome sequencing was negative, it's a very rational and rather cheap follow-up test to ask for a biomarker, because the biomarker will always tell you whether the patient is positive or negative. So that can help you to validate as well false negative whole exome interpretations.
Okay, thank you, Professor. I see a couple of more questions for you. So this one has come from Deepak. Are the biomarkers developed at CentroGene available only with the CentroGene, or is it widely available?
Well, the technology is published, and of course we are not the only one that offer that test, But as far as I'm aware, in a CAP-CLIA accredited laboratory, I wouldn't know other suppliers, and I would always invite you to send your samples to our laboratory, a set with the filter card. We have a very simple logistic solution, and you can really save more money on the transportation going to Sentogene than going for another supplier that might offer maybe the test cheaper. But just contact our regional sales for more information on that.
Thank you. We have another question from Cheryl. Can this biomarker be used beyond diagnostics and tell us anything about disease severity? For example, can it be used to help identify the level of disease progression in an already diagnosed individual?
So that's a very important and very relevant question. So of course, a diagnostic biomarker is nice. If you have a therapeutic biomarker that is as well expressing severity, it's even much better. So what we've seen with this biomarker, and it's a little bit as well included in this figure, that sometimes patients that receive miglustat therapy have biomarker levels in the normal range. So clearly there is sometimes a reduction of biomarkers. But we've seen, other than in other diseases, this is not generally the rule. So we cannot use the biomarker for titration, or let me put it a little bit different. We don't have evidence how established this link might be. This can be due to the mode of action of miglustat, or can be due to the biomarker. At the moment, we are monitoring that and collecting data. And as soon as we have a consistent view on that question, we will try to come up with an answer. But at the moment, I have only this anecdotal evidence that the biomarker at least sometimes reflects as well therapy and efficiency of therapy. Also, this is not validated in a clinical study. It's only an anecdotal observation.
Okay, thank you. We have another question from Svarup, and it goes like this. Are there any hotspot mutations in the gene or population-specific mutations?
Yeah, that's as well a very good question. The mutations are scattered all over the gene, so there's three domains characterized, but there's not domain-specific phenotypes. The most frequent mutations are in the carboxy terminal region, and especially there is the P1007A, which is quite frequent. But we see not a very tight genotype-phenotype correlation. So depending on the mutation type, be it a nonsense or a missense or a truncating frameshift mutation, we can only usually state that patients with homozygosity for truncating mutations are more severely affected than those with missense variants, but there is as well very severe missense variants around.
Thank you. We have a couple more questions. One comes from there's from William, and it goes like, what is the cellular origin of LISO SM509?
Sorry, can you once again?
Yeah, what is the cellular origin of LISO SM?
Yeah, that's something we cannot tell you at the moment. So the molecule was not able to crystallize the molecule, and so we have, of course, a clear characterization of this molecule, but I don't know how it arises in the pathophysiology.
Mm-hmm. And there's one more question from William, and it goes like this. What is the earliest point in time that this biomarker appears? Would it be present from conception?
Yeah, it's present from conception, or let's say conception, probably not, but the earliest analysis we could make was fibroblasts from prenatal samples, and in the positively diagnosed, we can already measure the biomarker then. But again, no systematic data there available. We have systematic data postnatally. There it's expressed and present in the symptomatic patients. That's what we know. But we don't know whether a late onset patient will already have elevated biomarkers in childhood. I would assume probably not very pronounced, so that this just builds up over time.
Thank you. And now we have the final question. Mm-hmm. What is your view of trihydroxyclonylglycine as compared to lyso-SM-509?
You're talking on the direct comparison of the keto trio biomarker and the lyso-SM-509. So my view is, when you look at the data, at least the data we could provide, 509 has a little bit better dynamic range. The healthy controls are more stable or are less noisy. And so I think in these terms, it's a good marker. Moreover, of course, we can do it from dried blood spot filter cards. And the imperil detection of Niemann-Pick type AB might be also an advantage as a biomarker, because then you can screen and make an easy follow-up analysis, whether it's AB or C.
Thank you, Professor.
And you're welcome.
Thank you for your answers. So with this, we could conclude the webinar. And if you have some more questions, please don't hesitate to send them by email, and we will be happy to answer them. Thank you very much for joining us.